A very good morning. Now, without wasting any much more time, let's start with the 5 minutes presentation, which is specially for you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. It was great seeing the presentations for today, and it's an honor for me to start the fundamental research group presentation, which will summarize the work which we've done for the past 2 months. Let me start with the first group, which is the data analytics workbench for educational data. The data analytics workbench for educational data basically had two components in it. The first part was the data loading component. Data loading in the sense how the data which was present in the form of dumps, log files, and basically uncluttered data had to be formed, organized, and placed into tables such that they could be directly used by data analysis researchers as well as professors. The second component which we added was the data visualization part, so that any professor as well as any researcher could easily visualize the data which has been put into the system. The challenges which we faced, as written here, some of them are for understand. We had to understand different types of EDX data. We had to extract useful information out of complete garbage in the form of logs. We had to actually find out and split. We had to do a lot of cleaning, transforming, and actually get the useful information out of a lot of unclean data. We had to automate the whole ETL process so that it works with a simple user interface. And finally, we had to integrate the whole data loading and visualization with a single, easy to use user interface. What we learned, big data technologies, various web technologies which were used for visualization, as well as server backend such as Django. Finally, the importance of good documentation, which Nagesh sir has taught us, and the teamwork which all of us had. Some of the future work is actually applying predictions and more data mining on this, such as sequential data mining, detecting undesirable student behavior, detecting student dropouts, and finally integrating the Django front end with a multi-node cluster. The second project was to actually create a recommender system. Since although EDX is providing all this data to us, we actually have to analyze this data and provide certain recommendations so that students who have applied once can actually find and filter, we can get filtered courses according to what they actually like. For this purpose, we collected stored information, applied dynamic concept mapping, and a number of recommendation algorithms to get the perfect possible recommendation system. There are a number of challenges which were faced. A number of these was that initially the systems which were used were not were completely, like, there was a lot of manual work to be done, such as providing input matrices, a lot of time complexity problems. For this reason, some of the solutions which we proposed were, for example, for improving the time, we added an additional server backend in the form of an additional software, open source software, which we used. In addition to this, we semi-automated the complete input matrices system, which had to be initially provided by the teachers or the backend research users. What have we learned? Again, in this project, it was great that we learned how to use a Django web framework. We learned using tools such as Git and LaTeX. We understood how recommender systems actually work, different types of algorithms such as collaborative filtering, dependency, concept mapping, and finally how actually research work is conducted, and we also published a research paper on this topic. The next part was the third theme, which was actually once we have developed such a system, we've created a workbench, we've created a recommender system, but the point is the whole system which has created has to be actually load tested and balanced. In the sense, it has to be benchmarked, it has to be tested that actually how good is this system? Is this system going to perform efficiently? For this reason was the third project, which was load testing and benchmarking of big data. This is a simple block diagram which explains how our system worked. First, there was a cluster setup. Externally or locally, data was generated, pushed onto the cluster. The Hive tables, Hive is the SQL-like backend database system for big data. It was populated, the tables in that. Finally, a number of benchmarks were run on it, and there was analysis of these benchmarks which was done for different types and different variables. The achievements which we found in this was that we modified the source code of BigBench, and we were able to obtain much better analysis results as well as much better variable analysis on our data, and especially the factors which were affecting our data. The future scope of this project, firstly, we hope to release in open source the customized version of BigBench which we have created, analyze many more parameters, understand how mappers and reducers, which are vital to a big data system, can actually be optimized according, instead of actually being provided manually, can be automized, can be completely automated. The next project was the P4, which is actually integration of EDX and Moodle systems. One of the most important parts of this project was not only to actually integrate both the systems, but to ensure there is complete synchronization of data, there is a complete admin panel, and there is no loss of data in any of these systems. So the achievements which we had in this was that we were able to create a simple interface, one for EDX to Moodle, and as well as for EDX to EDX, by which we could actually transfer course data between EDX platforms of different colleges, as well as from EDX to Moodle. The problems which we faced was, one of the main problems was that the PDFs which were present were of huge sizes, so they had to be selectively queried and dumped by MongoDB. There was a lot of MongoDB querying which was required to actually remove the important part of the information. In addition, the images were stored in binary format, so they had to also be extracted, and in addition, those images had different detailed descriptions which had to be separately extracted. The future work which we aim to do is for synchronizing, complete synchronization of data between EDX and Moodle. In addition, the cache has to be restored in certain times in order to ensure that the data is updated. For this purpose, we had to actually, there has to be some more work which has to be done. And finally, we had to ensure perfect synchronization with real-time updating, which is still, some work is left on that as well. And finally, our fifth project, which was modifying the code blocks platform in the form of and integrating it to Simple Blocks, which is our own new platform, the customized version, so that generally newcomers who come into learning C or C++ initially have a lot of difficulty in actually grasping the whole programming concept. For this reason, this was a very vital project and has actually been implemented in many places in the Eklavya project. The achievements in this was that we were able to integrate the simple CPP package, which had been developed in IIT earlier. In addition, the simple blocks was now very easy to use. It can be added, it can be installed with a very simple installation script, as well as there's a help manual which is provided so that any difficulty which would have normally been faced by newcomers is easily eradicated. So certain problems which we faced was to ensure that the installation script is a single step process. There are no problems taken, and a first-time user just has to run the script in order to ensure that the software is installed. And also adding a side pane for certain sample programs so that first-time users can actually see how initially code should be written with the coding style and other requirements. Some of the future work which can be done, which is being going to be done, is firstly to integrate simple blocks with Moodle, and secondly also to ensure that a single click transformation from normal code blocks to simple blocks. With that, I would like to conclude. These are one of the many references which we've used. Apart from this also, we've used a lot. And we would like to thank all the coordinators, Nagesh Karmali sir, Firuza ma'am, Sukla ma'am, anyone who I may have missed out. Thanks a lot. And most of all, obviously, Fatak sir, for helping us.
You said EDX logs have a lot of garbage. Actually, there are a lot of events, many of whom may not concern most of the people.
Yeah.
Roughly, what is the size of the logs that are produced by, say, one person's interaction over a week, approximately?
Yeah, in our main presentation, we showed that actually around 0.02 GB of data is produced by interaction of a student in around 2 to 3 hours. So, if you have to just... Like it's a simple number crunching.
You said apart from Django and MySQL, you also studied JIT.
Yeah.
So JIT. On the GitHub, are you now familiar with the process of how JIT maintains versions and things like that?
Yeah, we are aware of how GitHub actually works, how you can actually add new versions, how you commit your code, and how you can actually revert back to your old code in case there are some problems.
So I hope that was useful.
Yeah, it was very useful.
EDX to EDX,
yeah.
There is a facility to export a course and import a course.
Yeah.
Does that export-import only work about the course contents, or does it also carry with it the entire data for students and everything?
only the course contents.
Oh, I see. So what you have done is you can actually transfer the entire data for a running course also.
Yeah.
To something else.
Yeah.
But I thought that should still be straightforward. Is it complex or there is just...
Yes, sir, sir. Sir, you have to also update the course. Suppose there is a change in the course of course A, then that change should also be reflected in course B also.
Mm.
So that import-export will not solve that.
Okay.
So
I'm more worried about not the course, but the data concerning students who are registered, their performance, their quizzes and so on. Are you also ensuring that that data also goes on when you move a course from one place to another?
No, sir.
Or is it only about
only
course update?
Content.
Only the content. Nice. This simple code block, your team was working on Ubuntu or on Windows?
Both. Like we have made changes on Ubuntu as well as Windows. There were 2 6-month interns who worked on Windows. Like whichever changes we did in Ubuntu, the same changes have been done in Windows.
Sadly, I have just taken a decision that I'll not use the composite thing because I could not download and install it on my machine.
Ubuntu or Windows?
Yes. It's a Windows machine.
So Windows, like the point is the 6-month interns haven't actually uploaded the latest one on the JIT site. Ubuntu is working fine and we have uploaded the versions on Wicked.
You have done your work well.
Yes, sir.
And that thing is working fine.
Yeah. And actually,
where is your code?
On JIT. GitHub, it's uploaded.
On the GitHub, Ubuntu code is there.
The Windows code hasn't been uploaded by the 6-month interns yet.
Well, I compliment you for your work, but you can see what happens in a large team if one part of the team does not do its function.
Yeah.
The entire work is not usable. So the first course that I'll be offering now globally, as also to Indians, will sadly not have this. You don't understand. My recordings of all my lectures has to be frozen by today evening. I am already late by 1 week. Tomorrow I am going to record for 10 hours. And I will not record something which I cannot ensure that any ordinary student anywhere in the world is not able to download and install. So that is my problem. It's not because of you,
yeah,
but because of some other friends of yours that this problem is there. But anyway, rest assured that we'll use your code. Incidentally, this is not a question only for you, but for everybody else. In your documentation, have all the names been included of people who worked on the team?
Yes, sir.
And their photographs?
Yes, sir. Photographs are not there in the report.
Photographs are part of the presentation.
I already have seen your face.
Yes, sir.
The people who are going to see your work will not have this opportunity. You don't like your face? I think in whatever time it takes, but I think in a consolidated document where you put all the projects that you have done and give references to the GitHub or wherever you have the repository, but the credentials should include names, affiliations and a photograph. I think at least, see, I am so proud of what you have done. Shouldn't you be? And wouldn't you like the rest of the world to see who you are? So I would suggest that. Do you agree that this could be done? Right. Okay, thank you. Next room.
Good evening, everyone. We are representing the FOSSI team, which is the free and open source software for engineering education. I'm working on Sandhi, which is an open source alternative to LabVIEW. There's Amardeep, who's working on the OSCAD. Then there is Debashish, who's working on Textbook Companion. Then there is Varun, who's working on Image Compression. Now, these are all the projects which we have worked on during the entire 2 months span. First one is Sandhi, which, as I said, it is an open source alternative of LabVIEW. Then they have developed, the OSCAD team has developed a version 2.0, which is a comprehensive EDA tool. Then there is Python Textbook Companion. Then the next one is Scilab Octave interface. And then the last one is image processing for assessment of kidney injury. Now, Sandhi, this is the task that we've accomplished over the time. The first one was deploying custom blocks for the purpose of control engineering. Sandhi was basically focused on dealing with experiments which are related to control engineering. Then we uh, the plots which were existing in Sandhi weren't up to weren't perfect. So we improvised on the plots which were there, and then we deployed new plot blocks as well. Then the major aim of Sandhi was to incorporate it with virtual labs so that it can be remotely accessed using a browser, and you can perform experiments just by sitting at your home and use IIT Bombay's hardware to perform the experiments. So, and the last one was interfacing different hardware using through Sandhi to Sandhi, and the various hardwares have been interfaced. A few of them are the quadruple tank. Next. Yeah, so the challenge is faced. Sandhi has been forked from something known as GNU Radio. Now the problem was GNU Radio doesn't have a very good documentation. The documentation was highly insufficient, and it took us a good amount of time for all of us to figure out how exactly things are going on. Then the communication between the browser and Sandhi was again a big problem, because the approach that we chose earlier was not perfect, and then there are still some problems that we have faced which are regarding the security. Then the third one was understanding the GNU Radio framework. As I said, there was no proper documentation. There were loads of files. The GNU Radio software comprised about 500 to 600 MB, and then there were thousands of files which had thousands of lines of code. So there were times when we had to go through multiple files just to figure out where to look for what is the problem and identify the problem, then find a solution for it. Now future work. Now we are trying to bring Sandhi to a position where you can be it can be comparable to LabVIEW. Now the one aspect is the appeal that it has in front of the users. It has to be appealing. It has to look graphically sound. So the GUI aspect of Sandhi is not what has been touched till now because of lack of time. Then the next is security considerations for remote triggering. Right now the way the browser and Sandhi are interacting is not perfectly secure, and somebody can access your files just by using the mode that we are providing. Then third one is robust testing. As was pointed out by Sir in the presentation that we had yesterday, a robust testing needs to be carried out so that each and every test case is considered, and we get a when we deliver something which is acceptable and it works for almost everything. Now I would like to give it to Amardeep, who will explain about OSCAD.
Basically, OSCAD is an EDA tool, an electronic design automation tool, which has been created as an open source tool, and attempts are being done for making it comparable to Cadence and OrCAD, which are proprietary softwares. They are too costly, and also it's the only open source tool which has included all the features like creating schematics, then simulating them, as well as going for fabrication. So the new features that the interns over here have added to it in the past 2 months are, first of all, the PSPICE to OSCAD schematic converter. Using this, any user initially used PSPICE can then migrate to OSCAD, the free open source source. So use the same schematics, convert it to OSCAD, and then simulate them and run them. So that is one of the new features. Then a Python waveplot has been added, which will act as a replacement for the ngSpice plots, which doesn't give much functionalities to the user. And third is the GUI for KiCad to the ngSpice netlist converter. Basically a netlist is an input to the ngSpice for simulation purpose. Now the netlist that KiCad generates is cannot be used for simulation purpose. KiCad is a separate tool just for PCB designing. So its netlist has to be passed and converted as an input to the ngSpice. So that has been added. Then the subcircuit creation and addition of model libraries. What KiCad libraries are, as I said, it cannot be used directly for simulation. So you need to create sub-circuits, proper circuits for components like IC555 or a 7805 or an op-amp. So for that, the sub-circuits have been created and added to OSCAD. And finally, optimizing and redesigning of OSCAD. Before we came here, OSCAD has many discrete windows. So currently, the students what have done is instead of having discrete windows, they have all merged it into the KiCad source code. So they have worked on the KiCad source code and implemented all the buttons within the eSchema window itself, so that the user it will be easier for the user to simulate and run the circuits. So the challenges that were faced by the students were first of all the KiCad source code is all there are lots of thousands of files. So first of all getting into the files and knowing what stuff is where, so that was one of the challenges. Then the generation of the object files from the source files, the interaction between the C++ and the Python files. The earlier whatever has been written in OSCAD, it's mostly in Python. and making changes to the KiCad source code and using the same code wasn't too easy. So, and to understand the format of the schematic file of PSPICE as well, like as I said, the PSPICE converter that has been added. So we have to understand like what format the PSPICE schematic has, and then like accordingly pass it so that the KiCad like it becomes usable in OSCAD. The coming to a future work. Now, like as we have converted the PSPICE schematics for OSCAD, similarly we are working on converting the fridging schematics for OSCAD. Like fridging is again our PCB designing tool, so that like different users can like easily use OSCAD for simulating their circuits. Then we have, yeah, the one of the like major tasks that's going on, and hopefully we'll finish before we leave, the complete integration of the individual works. Like we have been working individually on different modules, so like 90% of the work has been completed, and hopefully we'll complete by tonight. And the next step will be robust testing it for like thousands of circuits so that the user won't have any issues. Okay, then finally releasing of the new OSCAD version, which we call as OSCAD version 2.0. thank you.
The task that we were assigned to was the Python textbook companion. The Python textbook companion basically is a repository to store all the solved examples from engineering textbooks coded in Python. The main task that we were assigned to was the review of the already existing Python textbook companion, and also we were asked to integrate an online Python interpreter so as to enable online editing of the already solved Python examples. And also we were asked to create a discussion forum which could link to each example such that queries or bugs related to that specific example could be reported or could be discussed. The main challenge that we faced during this Python textbook companion implementation was that the implementation of that online interpreter. We had to set up the server, and we had to take all the security measures as because we were implementing an online interpreter. So as such, we had to implement the chroot environment, and then we had to take all the possible security measures so as to avoid any kind of malicious activities going on. And talking about the future work, the currently what is going on is that the submission procedure starts with an email, so that and then the TBC team requests for sample books. Now all these things could be can be implemented or integrated over the Python TBC website only, and there should not be any requirement of email submission.
Hello sir. We were given a task to promote Scilab, because Scilab was basically the mainstream idea was that Scilab can only be used for computational procedures, and it is not in that much competence with the MATLAB where the image processing is concerned or the conversion of files are concerned. So the first project which was related to Scilab was Scilab Octave interface, which was done by Babu Reddy. He executed the Octave commands in Scilab. He made an interface between Octave and Scilab, and then he made the virtual GUI for Octave also. And the challenges which he faced was getting Scilab variable values and running the third party packages. The task which was given to me was, next slide. It was basically the image processing of an assessment for the kidney injury. I got an image of kidney injury from the microangiography of using a confocal microscopy of a kidney. So like it was basically to prove that complex images like biomedical images or for using it in biomedical applications, Scilab can be used for the processing of those images also. So that image was consisted of the red part and the green part. The red part was basically the injured part. So after processing the image was successfully filtered into the two parts, red and the green parts. And then the locations of the logical image, which was converted, the image was converted into logical form. And the locations of the patches, the injured patches were formed, were identified in the pixel values. And then using that, we found out where in the capillaries the injured parts are present. The challenges which I faced was, basically in Scilab, only morphological operations takes place, like only this shapes and sizes it considers, but the kidney capillaries are not of a definite shape. So that was a basic challenge which I faced. And second thing was the edging of the patches from which we can get the centroid of the of that injured part, and then find the distance between the healthy capillary and the injured capillary so that the person, the doctor, can perform operation. So that's it. I would like to call.
I would like to conclude. I'm sure that all of us are carrying something which is technical, some technical aspects that we've learned over here over the past 2 months. But there is something else that also we're learning here, that is working in a team. The working in a team part, which was an amazing experience, because you were working with somebody who's better than you or probably as good as you, and keeping them along, considering every aspect of, and there were various aspects, learning new languages, meeting with new people, being guided by amazing mentors. I would like to thank our mentors, our project manager, Mr. Kiran Kishore, and everybody else who's helped us along in putting all these work through to level where we are right now. Thank you so much.
This OSCAD thing, did you have a prior experience of design using such tools?
Yes.
So which tools did you use before coming here?
Before, for simulation purpose, like in our college, we use Multisim. But then, the case is, it's too old. I guess it's a 2007 version, and we have not been able to renew it. It's proprietary. And for PCB designing, I have been using KiCad, but separately. There is no simulation facility in KiCad. So in OSCAD, it's all brought up together.
If we need to, in general, recommend to our engineering colleges, that they should by and large start adopting open source software,
yes,
or ensure that they buy licensed version.
Yeah.
Where should such effort begin? Because for last 10 years I've been frustrated in telling principals and heads.
Yeah.
I've seen MATLAB being used by students virtually without any license, no trial license, yeah, no nothing. Some smarter people download a trial license, and the next month their friend downloads a trial license and so on. But so what is the situation? How do you think we can take this? Because I suppose that you now understand the importance of this work that is going on.
Yeah.
It's not only related to this, but also to
Scilab.
And
yes. The first answer is first of all, the teachers or the professors, they need to be contacted and helps some workshops. Once it's done, then even they will get to know that there are softwares which we can use, open source software, and even contribute to them.
It's a good idea. So, can I tell Professor Kannan that apart from holding training workshops on these tools, they should also hold sensitization workshops for the faculty and the administrators?
Yeah, sure. And students like me, now should be able to take it forward. I will make an effort. In my college, we should shift to OSCAD. Because for academic needs, it's sufficient. We don't need
How do you like the textbook companion scheme in general?
When we go for textbooks, it's too good. You get all the solutions, and the new feature that they have added, we can even edit it now. The new feature that they have added. So we can try out different stuff as well, with the code.
Okay. Good. Thank you. Good work.
Thank you.
Hello everyone. I am Kaushik Bhagwatkar with our whole iClass team here. So what is basically iClass? iClass means Interactive Classroom Live Audio Streaming System. So this is a main application package which is designed to reduce the communication barrier between a teacher and a student in the classroom. So what it basically consists of? It consists of three different modules. The first one is the Android app. Android app is for the student so that he can ask doubts or send audio request or audio doubt request to the teacher. The second one is the server app, that is for the professor. Professor can approve or disapprove any doubt that he would like to discuss or not. And the third one is the forum. The forum contains all those doubts that were not discussed in the class, but that should be answered later. So after that, we would like to show you demo, but
the challenges we faced were mainly in the client side. And the main challenge was echo. When our audio streaming started working, echo was there. The output from the speaker was feeding as an input to the microphone. So to remove the echo, we had to use an external C library, open source library Speaks. So to implement Speaks in our Java or Android code, we had to use the JNI, Java Native Interface, and the NDK, Native Development Kit, to make this work. and finally we were able to reduce the echo to a minimal level. And finally the future enhancements.
Future enhancements are, we can extend it to video streaming, that can be made possible. The second thing is we can also submit audio doubts in the forum. And thirdly, as suggested by Avinash sir, we can extend it to, like, professor can monitor the mischievous activities of all the students sitting in the classroom by the webcam or microphone. So, thank you, sir.
I don't approve of the third activity, which is completely unnecessary, and it presumes that students will not be smart enough to discuss some other way of doing exactly what they want.
Yeah, we can do that. Exactly.
I don't think that is workable. This system I have been attempting for a long time, starting with the early clickers.
Okay.
Mr. Rajesh Kushalkar actually got a microphone installed in the early clicker.
Yeah.
There also we had an echo problem. But the other problem that we had was that they could not actually put a sort of T at the receiving end, okay, where the question is also recorded on the server audio file and is also sent to the public speakers. So are you able to do that, or you just go to the server and that's the end of it?
No, we can do that. It's a live stream, so it's possible.
Can do that, or have you tried it?
Yeah, we have done that.
So currently we are just streaming it live, but no, we haven't tried that recording thing, because last year someone tried that recording thing, so it was essential for us to stream live and canceling that echo.
That's so now you can combine this and that, because
yeah,
it is during streaming that the echo problem will come.
Yeah, yeah.
Good job. Let's see if we can actually use it. I have announced that in the December teachers training workshop, when we have 10,000 teachers assembled at 300 places, they will actually not wait for a microphone to reach them, but they will speak from their Akash tablet. So what is the backend server that you have? What processes are running?
So the server is, we have implemented in the Java Swing. So it can run independent of OS, any OS. We can use Linux, Windows or Mac.
Okay.
The client is Android app that can run on Akash tablet.
You may not have tested the app to run on the next version of Akash, say Jelly Beans, Android.
No, sir, we have tried on phones that has 4.4 Android. That is
so when the Akash 4 comes into the market in another couple of months,
it can run it.
Product,
for
it
sure.
It will run seamlessly.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you,
good
sir.
Good job.
I, Pallavi Reddy, on behalf of edX Analytics, I'm going to say what we have done for the whole of 2 months. I want to thank Pathak sir for giving us the opportunity to work on such an interesting project. Actually, we all know that edX, the documentation is not completely proper. So we had to had a lot of time to analyze the actual log data coming. And we manually sat, we categorized all the events, and basically we categorized totally into 8 events, which we stored in our own database. And from here, based on the research paper by Baker, we have extracted some features like how much a student is seeking a video, the activity level of a student, and also the problem solving ability of a student, and mapped them into some integer values which we have given as input into Weka, which will classify whether the student is gaming or not. And also we have worked on data visualization, in which we have plotted graphs of student dropouts according to the weeks and also versus the demographics, the gender, the education level, etc. The challenges faced were the log parsing mainly. From the test which was generated over here, it only consisted of the questions but not the video information. So we all sat and on the Akash Lab server edX, which was installed there, we gave some videos. We noted down manually whether we are gaming or not as a test as an input for the training set. And also we had to synchronize the log file with the database which we have created in Hive. And on this we have written queries, which includes incremental queries that suppose till this log entry the input has been already processed, then we have to process after that input. That also we have covered. And one more challenge which we faced during feature extraction was obtaining the video information. We did not have any particular database which gave us the video title or duration. So what we did, we wrote a different Java package which will download the JSON object from internet itself and get the title and duration. And future. And what we learned was that all the big data technologies, Hadoop, Hive, Scoop, setting up a Hadoop cluster, processing and querying big data using Hive and working with all the specific Hive queries, which is actually somewhat like SQL. And we also have given the .arff file for Weka as input, which gave us an accuracy of 71% according to one algorithm, logistic regression. And we have also used Hive charts for data visualization, as I've mentioned before, which will be a good feedback for the tutors and designers to understand how well their course is going on. And as far as future enhancements, we can, after classifying the students as gaming or not, we can actually add interventions and extract more features learning from the Baker's paper. Thank you.
So Baker's paper was a central theme for most of your activities, is it?
No sir, not Baker's paper. Yes, Pushpak sir has actually advised us that. So we started reading it. Okay. From the features which we used, we tried to extract three features.
This stuff is pretty new for most of our BE curricula in the country.
Yes, sir.
So for you, this was the first exposure to these things?
Yes, sir. First exposure.
So Hive, Peg, Hadoop,
yes, sir, completely.
Everything.
We wouldn't have got a chance to learn it on our own. It was
and
IIT. Hubert.
This was like baptism by fire. You had to jump into the ocean to learn swimming.
Yes, sir. And
did you enjoy that?
Yes, sir. It was very
interesting. I can see that you have survived, but did you learn?
So actually, it was interesting because we could use our own ideas. There was no compulsion on us that you have to do this, you have to do that. We came up with our own ideas from the whole thing. And
why was log parsing a big problem?
So
because I thought the documentation of the event logs is pretty exhaustive.
Sir, but the events classification to see which event is going to give a indication that the student is gaming, classifying that, creating a database of our own, and we have different tables for different events. Then we are writing queries on them to extract.
I did not understand the reason for synchronizing the two databases, because you have actually the events flow out of the main database, right? When the students.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I was talking about the synchronization of the log data generated into our program.
Into okay. Your program.
Into our program.
It's not really synchronization, it's just
fetching.
Yeah,
new data.
I mean, assimilating that log.
Yes, sir.
Good. But can you see where the world is going? I hope all of you have actually been present when the detailed presentation was made.
Yes, sir. We had a thorough questionnaire with sir also.
Oh, that would happen. But let me tell you the importance. See, when you scale up the education, as it is today, classroom size from 35 increased to 45, increased to 50, increased to 100. In a class of 100, and I have a class of 500, for example, it is absolutely impossible for teacher to know in time what an individual student has not understood. So we have been talking about the personalized tutoring system for decades. I mean, it's not something new. That you do through this analytics. It was attempted long time ago. So the idea is that if a student is weak in some concept, you immediately advise the student to study something more, etc., etc. And that was not possible earlier. This analytics that you speak of, incidentally, there is a group in MIT which is working on speeding up this analytics for even 100,000 students, such that the categorized feedback for groups of students. You don't deal with an individual student, but you deal with, let's say, 20 groups at different levels of understanding. And these 20 groups for each and every concept. And then the teachers are designing what is the appropriate additional material, additional quizzes that should be given to these individuals. And this does not have to wait for 1 month, after which a conventional test is conducted and a teacher can find out. And from the conventional test, it's extremely difficult for the teacher to find out the mistaken notions or knowledge in individual concept. You have 5 questions in a test and people answer a question right or wrong. You can't get that granularity. So this is where the future education is moving. Unfortunately, most teachers and university administrators have not understood the importance and relevance of this. So what little work this group has done, similar work that is being done elsewhere, and I tell you, within 5 years, if we move our butts collectively, it can actually make a difference to a lot of students. So now it does not matter whether a teacher is personally aware of things through personal interaction or not. But your interaction on the machine would be able to tell the teacher that you need this more, you need that more, and so on. So let's hope that something good comes out of it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. The work which was assigned to us was to create a website for the Akash tablet users so that they can submit their queries and get solutions. And we have created basically two modules, the discussion forum and the ticketing system using Python and Django. In the discussion forum, the users are allowed to post the questions and get answers to their queries. And they have the facility to ask a question and search the questions through the tags. And in the ticketing system, if they can interact with the experts from IIT Bombay, if they don't get the answers through the discussion forum. Last year, this site was implemented in PHP and OS Ticket, and this time we have implemented it in Python and Django. And last time in the ticketing system, the admin had the facility to close the ticket, but this time the users have the facility that if they are satisfied with the answer, they can close the ticket. The challenges that we faced were when we tried to integrate the two modules, the discussion forum and the ticketing system, we have created two separate apps for that. So we had little problem in that regarding the URLs, and when we were embedding the Django code in the Bootstrap framework, so there were certain difficulties in that. In the future enhancements, the video chat can be implemented so that the users can directly have a conferencing with the experts from IIT Bombay. Thank you.
So what was this problem for integrating Django with Bootstrap? I did not understand.
Sir, when we use the models, no? So if the user was not able to register properly, so models don't have any URL associated with them. So in the
what is the backend database that you are using for storing all?
For development purpose, we have used that SQLite3 database. But once we deploy it on SMTP server SQL, MySQL database will be used.
And your code is such that it does not matter what the backend database is.
It doesn't matter. So that's the beauty of Django. In Joomla, there were difficulties in integrating certain features.
That is
true. If I want a plugin to be installed, there were features. Thousands of lines of code should have been changed. But in Django, a different module can be directly
integrated. Well, I'm happy you discovered that, and I'm happy that this technology is useful. Incidentally, for everyone, as we speak, day before yesterday, I got an urgent call from the ministry that the mhrd.gov.in site has to be modified, and they are desperately looking for Drupal experts, and the whole thing is in Java. One important concept behind any website is that if the administrator wishes to change any contents which are displayed, you should not require a programmer. So can you guarantee that? Suppose on your website I want to change the front end message. You say, I just want to make it that now Akash 4 query is also supported. Just one, this single sentence. No, but how do I do that? You can guarantee, but what is the process? You can guarantee it by tweaking the Django code that you have written. No.
Content, the content that is visible to the users, huh, that you have to change.
So that can be changed. Are these editable pages?
Yeah, editable.
Okay.
So there is a different, means like MTV model, the basic common model template and view. So templates is
separate, and so that you have done. So you said you are not familiar with these technologies when you came here.
A little bit.
How long did it take to learn it? Not very difficult.
2-3 weeks.
So as we implemented, we learned them.
So you learned something new.
Yes, sir.
You have done something useful.
Yes, sir.
Did you work with Parag's team?
Yes, sir.
So Parag, has that been now integrated on your site? Or you are waiting for next year summer interns? No. So forget video chat application, but this updated version, who in your team is in charge of the Akash site? So tell him to launch this. When will you be able to launch this? It should have been done before these people went away, so that in case there is any difficulty for the local people, you would be available on email or something?
Yes.
Because I want to show to the ministry in my next meeting in Delhi the updated website. So 15 days? 15 days. Who is the project manager? Write this down. Huh? 15 days is what Parag has committed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good work.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. We are from the Akash School Education team, and we have three amazing projects coming up for your consideration. I would like to start off with the first project, which is Virtual Labs, or basically Virtualis as we call it now. So what is Virtual Labs? It's we were put forth with the question as in the rural villages or in places which schools which can't afford labs or they can't provide these facilities to students. I mean, everyone has a right to education, so they should have this facility, right? So we thought, is there a way to actually implement the system and give it through the Akash tablet to them? So what have we implemented using Virtualis? We have a system, a web portal, wherein all the data related to an experiment, a lab experiment, can be uploaded. Data including theory, procedures, videos, simulations, quizzes, and so forth. With that, we have a completely synced Android application, which will be working on the Akash tablet, and for that matter, any platform, any device which is supporting Android. In that, it'll take the live data, it'll take the data directly from the database, and we have two features again in that. We have offline modes and we have online modes. Why the need for offline modes? Because students should have the right basically to store data if they're done learning an experiment. Maybe they want to revise it on the way to the exam or on the way to the school. They have this facility with them, right? So the two biggest features in this system which we have provided is the evaluative quiz and the simulation. I'll start with the evaluative quiz. After learning or going through the lab experiments, the student should know how much he has figured out in the system. So we provided a quiz, which will be uploaded by the contributor, of course, which covers an amazing 7 formats, starting from all true and false, matching, any multiple answers, it provides feedbacks, it allows for partial correctness of questions and everything. So basically a complete self-evaluation for the student, right? Let's move on to the guided simulations. Now, this was a pretty tricky job for us because just knowing information and not performing it can be a little destructive. Because it's a lab, students should know how to perform it, right? So in simulations, we basically added two features. If you have a Blender file, an animation, which will work on the Akash tablet, you can go ahead and upload that. But if you don't have that, because creating Blender files, of course, is time-taking, right? We made our own platform of creating simulations for the contributor. So if they feel that they can use our platform to make an interactive simulation, which the student can further use, he can go ahead and he can use it. Yeah, thanks. This is how the Android interface and the web interface looks like, and they completely sync, like I said earlier. Right. So the challenges. Like I said earlier, the simulation, basically debating about it, thinking of the different ways we can actually implement the system. Because the main point was it should work on the Akash tablet. And things tend to get slow, so we had to keep it optimized, right? So now we have such a system in place. Second challenge, of course, was syncing the entire content. Because, like I said, everything which can be performed on the web is transmitted to the app. So the student can perform everything and go through the entire experiment, including videos, simulation, performing everything, doing the evaluator quiz, everything on the tablet. Now, the quiz module, like I said earlier, we use the GIFT Moodle system, which basically gives us a format to evaluate ourselves, to give feedbacks and stuff like that. In the end, managing the entire content in a very efficient system was very important because we had so much to deal with. And we needed to make sure that everything remains optimized, that the tablet itself, if you're storing data, right, it shouldn't get burdened with a lot of data, right? So basically for that, we use systems of storing the cache instead of storing the actual data. So that reduces the load. Again, what did we learn in this entire period? I would like to point out the greatness about this thing that we never actually did Android work. We never used it basically before. And we started from scratch. So my entire team learned Android from scratch and we were able to implement this. We learned other systems like a canvas for simulation and stuff like that, and LaTeX for the documentation, of course. Right. Now, what is the future enhancement in the system? In this, we have coded it from the beginning such that it is highly scalable. It can be extended now to any situation. We can go ahead with language localization to take it to places where, you know, people may not understand, they just have their regional languages, so we can go ahead with that. We can provide more functions in the simulation. As of now, we just have a set of 67 features. So we can add more functionality in that, making it more interactive for the student. Things like pouring water or showing an actual reaction happening on screen, right? Things like that. Then for the contributors part of you, making it more simple for the contributor to actually upload data, because that is the entire essence, right? So a GUI for adding quizzes, he doesn't need to upload the GIF format or basically even know about it. Then as of now, we just have a contributor module in the web interface. How about moving it onto the tablet? As in, contributor has the access. If he has access to tablet, he can upload experiments directly from there, right? And then we can have student profiles. As of now, we had this quiz to a self-evaluation system. Maybe we can take it across and make it competitive. See how other students perform. Sorry, yeah. Things like that. Yeah. So basically, what have my team achieved in this 2 months is now, ladies and gentlemen, so if we give an Akash tablet to any student or basically any device which has Android capabilities, we are basically providing them an entire laboratory. Thank you. I would now move on to the next amazing project, the eval.
I'll explain about our second project, that is eval. It's a group and peer based quizzing system for classrooms. The main objective of our project is that there should be increased student-student interaction as well as the learning should enhance. Now for that, we have designed an inter-group quizzing system which will enable students to ask questions among themselves. At the end of the quiz, the system itself will generate a performance and finally give an analysis to the teacher for knowing the students' performances. Now this is the entire block diagram of our system. Here we have the server on which the teacher will be sitting. We have Android tablets which each client will be having. Every student is a client. And we have an Wi-Fi access point to which the clients and the server will be connected in the network. Now, the server has interfaces to connect to the clients as well as the data backend database. Now, what we need a database for? We need database for storing student and teacher's details. Again, at the end of quiz, we'll need to store the performances as well as the questions that are asked during the quiz. So the server has the interface to interact with the backend database. Now, the server can interact with the frontend also in form of a quiz module, which I'll be explaining a bit later. Coming to the client interface, the client also has an option to view the performances as well as the questions that were asked during the quiz. Also, the client can change their password once they log in into the system. Also, the teachers can save files for future referrals and study materials. The clients can download those files and use those for study. Now coming to the quiz module, the teacher, when she wants to start a quiz session, she'll initiate the quiz session and she'll fill few parameters for the quiz. Based on those parameters, the parameters are the number of students in the class, the total number of groups that should be formed for the quiz, the maximum size of the groups, and also the number of rounds in the quiz. These parameters are filled by the teacher and those are submitted to the server. Now what will happen is that all the clients, when they log in, all the students, they will get the instructions along with the interface for becoming a leader. Now we require a leader for each group. So the main advantage of the leader is to bring a unity of command in the group and also not to overload the network as well as the teacher with lots of questions. Now the leaders, after students get the interface for becoming a leader, they will either search for becoming a leader or against it. Now the students who press for becoming a leader, the request will go to the server and the leaders will be selected. And those leader name will be forwarded to all the students. Now the students, they will select among the leaders and select preferred leaders, and this way the groups will be formed. After the groups are formed, the entire quiz is ready to start. The teacher will just enter two more parameters, that is the questioning time and the answering time. Now after, she'll press the start quiz button and the quiz will start. Now here I would like to clarify two terms that we'll be using for the entire presentation. First is an active group. Active group is the group who will be asking questions, and passive groups are all the groups except the active group. Now after the teacher presses the start quiz button, the active group leader will get an interface to write a question along with the answer and send it to a teacher. Now, after the question and sends the question, the teacher will receive the question and she will cross check the question about its validity. Suppose the question is not valid, she will press reject and the same group leader will again get an option to write the question and the answer. If she accepts it, there will be two things that will happen. One is that the question will be saved into the database for future reference, and the second thing is the question will be forwarded to all the other groups for answering except that group of which the leader formed the question. Now, when the question is sent to all the other groups, they will answer the question, and in that way they will answer the question, and that way the response will be sent to the server and the evaluation will be done there. Finally, at the end of the quiz, all the performances will be saved in the database, and in this way the quiz will continue and finally end. So this was the quiz module. So the coming to the challenges was, we used UDP broadcasting for the entire transaction of the quiz. We found that it became unreliable as packet dropouts were there, so we made UDP a bit reliable by introducing acknowledgement packets and retransmissions. Moreover, leader is an important member of the group. If he goes out, the system will halt. So what we did, we let the system choose another leader and the quiz would continue. What we have learned Android programming, network programming, that is the base of the entire system. Also, modifying an existing transmission protocol to serve repend was a huge learning curve. Again, working in group and teamwork was very exciting. Future announcement is that right now we assume that the intra-group communication will be physical. In future we can add a chat mechanism so that the groups can talk among themselves. Also, better data visualization for the performance viewer can be done, and peer-to-peer assignment evaluation can be added, in which the teacher will upload assignments and students will be able to submit, so and they will evaluate other students' assignments. So this is all. So I'll invite Priya.
Third project of our group is content contribution portal for school education. The country in which we are living, there are lot of students in the underprivileged area who don't have access to a quality, you can say quality education. So what if we are able to provide them a quality education, quality content that too contributed and reviewed by the renowned professors and teachers of our country. Our website is aims to bridge the distance between world-class education and underprivileged student who face difficulty in accessing quality education. This is the homepage of our website. It has all the functionalities which makes it easy to use for a contributor, a reviewer, or a normal user. Here we have a contributor who contributes the content. We have a reviewer for that who reviews the content. There is a proper system which ensures that the whatever content we are providing to student, that is filtered, means the content is appropriate for them. Our website is flexible enough to include all the classes, all the subjects, and even the language. If a student want to have in his own regional language, he can access that contents too properly. Meanwhile, the challenges which we faced, first one was to select a suitable WAV framework, but at the end we did it with the Django. We all were having a scarce knowledge of Python and Django, so at the beginning it was difficult for us to start. Moreover, we were many people, so at the end of the day, to merge our work was also a great thing for us. So at the end, we used a version control software, Git, for merging our works. In the 6 week stay at IIT Bombay, we have learned a lot. Our project was completely on Django, so yes, now we have a good knowledge of Python programming as well as Django framework. HTML, CSS and JavaScript, which we all learned for our UI, and of course the Git for merging our works.
I do not know how do you take it forward, not only just this particular thing, but the entire group's work, because the Akash project will be closing down at IIT soon. So the only way it can happen is if we have a thriving community across the country which will continue to contribute and spread. So good, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, a very good evening to the August gathering present here. I'm going to present the work which has been completed in the course of our internship. Nature 3D was the app developed by us. So Nature 3D is an interactive e-learning application designed to acquaint a student with the anatomy of human eye with its varied features, components, and functionality in the 3D viewscape. So the basic premise of this project was to enrich the academic appetite of a student, which in the present state is very bland. There are more texts than the visuals.
and to exploit the flexibility and unrestrictiveness of e-learning. So, and why I? Human Eye happens to be a part of the syllabi prescription for 8 to 10 standard students, and the cross-section of Human Eye is best viewed in 3D. So we chose eye model to continue with in our app. The workflow can be trichotomized into three basic platforms. We use Blender 2.7a platform for modeling and animation. So 3D model of Human Eye with the textures was created in Blender. Unity 3D Pro software was used to impute all the Android interactivity of touch, pinch zoom and swipe. It was also used to add the game logic, which was scripted in C# and JavaScript. And finally, all the bundled things were put to the Android platform and published as a .apk file, which was Nature 3D. So I'll quickly blitz you through a video of what our app is all about. So Nature 3D, clicking on logo, you get navigated to a splash screen. Our app has been trichotomized into three stages, which are Structure of Eye, Working, and Adaption of Eye. So in Structure of Eye, you get the options to explore the 3D model and a practice activity. Instructions to explore. So here you get the 3D model of Human Eye. On clicking on a component, it gets highlighted, and stitched to the left hand side is a panel for description and name of the component. So similarly, you can click components to know about them. You can use pinch zoom to zoom in and view the component at a closer perspective. So an interesting feature is the tablet tilt, or the use of the accelerometer. Here what you can do is tilt your tablet and pan the model, rotate the eye model, and see the features however you want of the human eye, very different components of it. So this accelerometer or tablet tilt option is a toggle button. You can click on it to enable or disable it. So I'm going to blitz this a few. The next part is practice activity based on the learning acquired from stage one, that is exploration. You get through some questions and four options for each of them. So clicking on the correct option will increment your score, and there is no negative marking. So this is a practice activity, and for the correct answer, you get at the bottom of your screen a description of the correct answer. So this was about the practice activity. The second module is working of the eye. This explains the working in two videos, basically how the image is formed in the eye for a normal eye and the one which has defects. So this is actually an animation which has been played. So this is how the image is formed for a normal eye and the one with defects like hypermetropia, myopia and presbyopia. Like in stage one, you get a practice activity here too, where the student or the user is reviewed for the videos that he learnt. Now the last stage is adaption of the eye, which has a video to impute the effect of light on pupil, like it dilates when the intensity of light decreases and it constricts on when there's high intensity of light, I'm sorry. And there's a practice activity where the user can actually manipulate the slider bar to know how the pupil actually reacts. So on low intensity, dilation happens, and high intensity, constriction. So this was basically the app. Okay, the challenges that we faced. A major challenge for us was deliberating on the choice of a game engine. We explored many open source game engines, but finally we converged to a point where we decided Unity 3D as a game engine. So Unity 3D is a proprietary software, but we chose it because what our USP was that graphics are more appealing to a student than text. So we could not compromise on the quality of graphics, and crisp graphics with textures were available only with Unity. Other open source game engines did not have the option of a sound documentation or the graphics quality. Another challenge for us was mapping the code which was generated via scripts to the device for deployment. Sewing the entire scenes and stages into an integrated module was a challenge. The major learning that we did was acquiring and polishing our skill set in Blender and Unity 3D. We started as noobs, and in 3 days we were acquainted with the entire Blender software. And 1 month old in Blender, we also conducted a Blender workshop for the team at eYantra. So that was a major part of our learning. That time we were the teachers for Blender. And Unity 3D also, after going through adding all the interactivities, manipulating each model and its components, we actually polished a lot of our skills. Another thing was time management. Because we had explored so many options for game engines, we had to set up notches in our timeline to stop and punctuate the exploration. So what we did was we saw if the basic interactivities are getting implemented in a software, then we chose it or we rejected it. So last learning was teamwork. The future scope that our app can be extrapolated to can be that multiple Indian languages can be introduced in the application. The same methodology can be applied on various topics, like not only for the human eye, we can model many parts for the human body. Okay, the user interaction can be extended further in the way. And okay, this application can also be used with real life 3D gaming devices such as Oculus Rift, which creates a virtual environment entirely for viewing this thing. So we're extremely grateful to our mentors and Professor Sameer Sahasrabadi and the environment that was provided at IITB. So we had 24/7 lab facility available and motivation was swimming all around. You just have to have the eye to see it. So we had seen days melting into nights back into days, and we were working together, working on an engine and getting to a point where we could say, ki aha, stop. So that was an experience which will enrich us throughout. We'll carry this around with us. So thank you, sir. And thank you for your patience.
There is a game engine as part of the Blender as well.
Yes, sir.
So what was the inadequacy there?
Okay, sir. Blender game engine was actually, what Blender game engine does is it restricts us with a Blender player. Like to play the application, to have the...
And the Blender player won't work on the Android.
You have to have it installed separately, the Blender player. So that is another restriction for the user. The user has to have Blender player to use the application.
Is there any community work in Blender going on to make that available on Android?
No, sir. Actually, it was taken as a GSOC project for 2012. But work on it has stopped right now and the code has been taken off from open source.
Been taken off.
Yes, sir. There's no code available for Blender player, so we could not tweak the code there and impute some Python scripting.
Perhaps then a good idea would be to start work on fresh gaming engine itself for Blender, which will work. No, they used a proprietary.
We use Blender for modeling and animation. Blender.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, good job. So this, by the way, why can't you adopt the spoken tutorial methodology? For example, the video you had,
yes, sir.
You were speaking.
Yes,
now,
sir.
Now, instead
yes,
of you, if somebody could speak in Punjabi or Tamil, absolutely, and record that and integrate it with the video, then it would become a tutorial.
We have a video for this with all these videos. We did not have this voice in this one. So, but the videos are absolutely done with voices. There are voiceovers in English. Right.
They're English?
Yes, sir. Right now they're in English.
With the script written or only the voiceover?
Right now there are voiceovers. We can add subtitles.
Is there an English script, written script for the voice?
Yes, sir.
Means whatever you're speaking, is it written down as text?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Then ask your mentors here to hand it over to the spoken tutorial team. And let them translate it into 17 languages. They do it pretty well.
That can be done, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Ek Shiksha is a social initiative with the aim of promoting self-learning and distance learning. At its very core, Ek Shiksha believes in the motto of India, one nation, one gyan. The Ek Shiksha group was divided into two projects, the question bank and assessment and the software arena. I'm going to explain the work that was carried out by the question bank and assessment team. The following slides outlines the work that has been carried out. Now the Ek Shiksha website has been functional for almost 2.5 years. Our team implemented the following features. A search functionality was added, allowing multilingual search along with a spelling correction in English. Then interactive exercises have been provided at the end of each chapter where 5 types of questions can be used by the users for self-assessment. Like and comment facility has a plugin actually has been implemented where the users can like and comment at the end of each chapter as well as for each activity. Then the read and extract questions and the database API. These two modules were very closely linked together, wherein questions which were submitted by the user, by the software contributors in ActionScript, were inserted into the database after a number of validity checks. A separate contribution portal was also implemented, wherein users can actually contribute as well as review the questions. And we also implemented Py in HTML5, where a number of ActionScript classes were translated into JavaScript. Moving on to the challenges faced. In implementing the search functionality was the categorical search, because we allow content to be searched either as textual content or interactive content. Then the extraction and insertion of a variety of questions. As already I've told you, we have the MCQs, the fill in the blanks, the crossword, and true and false questions. So these are a large variety of questions, and each of them requires separate type of functions to be written. Then the validity of each question. A number of validity checks had to be put. The magnitude of questions which were inserted into the database was approximately 11,000. So a number of validity checks had to be put. Support for regional and international languages. The main USP of the Ek Shiksha website is the support for the international as well as regional languages. So each of the features which were implemented had to provide support for the same. Support for image questions. The contribution portal also supports image questions, wherein users can upload images and relate questions to that. And use of inheritance in JavaScript. This was faced by in the conversion of the Py framework into HTML5. During the course of the project, we learned a number of valuable lessons. First of all, we learned the importance of teamwork. We had a very large team size. The question bank alone had 15 people working together. We learned how to write clean code with documentation, something which was rarely practiced by any of us. We also learned the importance of distance learning. And we learned how to work under pressure and meet deadlines. The technical challenges have not really been explained here, because they've already been discussed in the earlier presentation. Moving on to the future scope. Ek Shiksha will continue to grow as long as you all continue to contribute. So outlining the points for the future, we have we can implement spelling correction in the search functionality in languages other than English. So currently, if you spell electricity in English wrong, it can be corrected to electricity. But if you spell dhwani wrong, it will not be corrected. We can provide support for that. Then more question types like integer and essay type can be implemented. Only 5 types of exercises are supported as of now, but these types can also be included. Then the expansion of the new Py framework, FAQ portal implementation. FAQs, a link is already present in the site, but the portal has not yet been implemented. Only the documentation has been carried out. And implementation of a robust reviewer policy for the contribution portal. This slide shows the references from where we took help. Now, before handing over to the Software Arena team, I would just like to thank Professor Fatak, Mr. Avinash Avate, Mr. Rajnikant, and Mr. Mayank Paliwal. Thank you.
Good evening, all. As we all know, there are many learning portals available on the website. So here's one of our contributions, which is Impact, experiment with mentor-assisted programming and computing training. The difference between the various learning portals and us is that it is mentor-assisted. It is one-stop mentor-assisted learning programming for learning new subjects. This time we have implemented it for C. We'll implement it for various other languages. The components of Impact are learn, test your strength, and contribute. As we all know, while going through a learning phase, we need to have content, we need to build our concepts. For that, we have tutorials and examples. And the thing which makes our portal different from others is the searchable FAQs. The FAQs are dynamic. They keep on evolving as and when the mentor adds questions to the FAQs. For practice, we have question bank and auto grader, which is a very unique concept. For solutions to difficulties, we have a guaranteed mentor response, which is a faceless mentor, so as to simulate the real world. For test your strength, we have continuous improvement. We will have programming competitions for them. And contribute section is for improving the educational content on our website. The technical challenges that we faced are, our specifications were not clear. The requirements kept on changing. Now, integration of the code with the other team was quite difficult. We had to change our interface many a times because of the changing requirements. And application had a lot of interdependencies, so version control was also a bit challenging task. Other challenges we faced were inappropriate technical features like use of G-option pane, which is hard to control. Interdependencies of modules also created a lot of challenges. Technical achievements we learned were, we discovered our ability to learn different programming languages within a short time span. We created a fully functional portal. Along with its integration, which took a lot of time. We used Bootstrap for accessibility from all the devices. And we learned industry practices like coding conventions, exception handling, which we rarely use when we work alone. The soft skills were to work as a team, to integrate with all, to work under pressure, to have flexibility in order to meet the project timelines. The future scope of our project is, as I told, this is an experiment, so we need to have a valid check whether it works successfully or not. So the future scope is to validate the experiment, to extend it to multiple languages, not just in programming context, but also to have multilingual support so that people from various parts of the world can learn this. Integrate the auto grader is one of our future scopes, which has not been done as yet. And to have the visibility of our website on all the social media. At last, I'd like to thank Professor Pathak and Avati sir for giving us this opportunity, and also our mentor Aparna ma'am for guiding and assisting us throughout the time. Thank you.
Good evening. We represent the CDEEP group, and we'll quickly go through the 5 projects that we have done under this group.
Good evening, one and all present here. So this is my project, interoperability between video conferencing and web conferencing. So first of all, we are provided with 2 environments, video conferencing and web conferencing. But if a web client want to interact with the video client, then it is not allowed here. So the technology we have used here is like SIP protocol is for the video client, RTMP protocol is for the web client. The software we have used here is Akiga and Exalite for the SIP client testing. The codecs we have used here is the SPIX for audio, H.264 is for video, and the language we have used is Python and JavaFX. So the basic flow of the process is that there is a web client, there is a video client. First of all, web client has to register itself in the RTMP server. The SIP client has to register itself to the SIP server. There is a SIP RTMP server that behaving like a gateway, and then the translation and transcoding between their language, like RTMP to RTP and the RTP to RTMP. So basically, after facing the challenges like browser restrictions, plugin restrictions, codecs restrictions, we have coming to the final output, and this is our final output that we have come with a web client and a video client. Like this is a SIP phone, and this is a SIP client, and this is the video client, and we are able to communicate bi-directionally audio and video between us. Thank you. Next is.
Good evening, everyone. I'm here to give a brief description of our project, Media Asset Management. Why Media Asset Management? To avoid looking for files at different places, to deliver the files, to reuse those, and to keep tracks of the rights and permissions of the assets, and to preserve those. So basically, a centralized storage system. The technologies that we used, Apache, PHP, YI framework, and MySQL for database. The basic flow is like an asset is uploaded, it goes for the reviewer to get reviewed. The reviewer can either authorize or reject, and the notifications are done accordingly. So the final result is a MAM, where we have the following features: creation, review, and approval of assets, multiple file supports, role-based access control, alerts, searching or indexing, version control, and logs. Thank you.
Good evening. I'll be giving a brief description of the project title Concept Tutor, under which we have developed 2 educational games. The main motivation behind this project was that there are plenty of applications already available for the Android operating system which focus on subjects like science and mathematics. But there is an unavailability of Indianized and localized applications which focus on subjects like social sciences. The technology that we have used for developing the games is Unity Gaming Engine. Using this engine, first of all, we are implementing 6 different types of gestures, which are touch to select, drag and drop, drag and move, drag to draw, scroll, and pinch to zoom. We have used these gestures to implement the 2 games. The first one, which is the civics game, basically has these 8 main areas, which are eligibility of candidates for the elections of the Gram Panchayat, the entire election procedure, and solution of various issues or case studies. The different kinds of puzzles or games that we have used inside the civics games are multiple choice questions, match the following, and jumble words. The second game, which is based on geography, has three sub-games, which are placing the states onto the map of India, drawing various physical components onto the map of India, and identifying the neighboring countries. Thank you.
Good evening, one and all. I am here to give a brief on development of forum for interconnectivity with handheld gadgets. So the basic motivation behind the development of forum that we want it to be different so that it can support media and it can interconnect with the handheld gadgets. The technologies used were Bootstrap for the developing the front end, Spring MVC for the development framework, and MySQL as the database. The features that were developed in the forum were that we were able to upload the answers in audio, video, text, and image format, and we were able to develop two applications, one Android app and another messaging service app, through which we can post questions even without internet connectivity so that it can be easily accessible to every place. And so these were the goals achieved. We can post the questions through these two apps and it will go to the portal, and once we click on any question, then the video corresponding to that question will be played. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'll be briefing on network simulation and bandwidth monitoring tool that we have developed. The basic motivation of the project was to overcome the limitation of the network simulation tool TCS VANM, developed by TCS. TCS VANM is a very commonly used network simulation tool, but it has many drawbacks, like it runs over a not so common NOPIX Linux, and simulation of a single client is only possible. So we have come up with solutions that are which solve these problems and also add our own features. Like we can simulate the network over multiple PCs, and we can include network monitoring, and we have displayed the results in graphs, and we are planning to release this as a Linux package. So these are the technologies we have used: Django as a backend, MySQL database, and simple bash scripting. So these are the results that we have generated, so a developer can monitor his application.
In the end, I would like to thank Professor Fartak sir for providing us this internship opportunity, Mr. Deshmukh sir for guiding us throughout the internship, and the entire CDF team for making this project happen. Thank you.
How many codecs did you look at before finalizing on H.264, or you just made that choice and then proceeded?
Sir, we are restricted for the H.264 because this is one of the R&D type project and this is not implemented yet. So now we are the soft phone we are using. So for that only video we can restrict it for the H.264 codecs also, and further we can go for the different codecs for the video also, because like H.264 is described as a best now for the in network or for better resolutions. Or
there's one more advantage: it is freely available in multiple platforms.
Yes sir, it's freely available.
All other codecs have a huge challenge in,
yes sir,
in their licensing and all things.
Yes sir.
How much of things that you did here you were familiar with before you came to IIT?
Sir, basically personally I have no idea about anything. I have learned a lot here, like SIP protocols, RTMP protocol. These all are very new for me, and it's really a very new project and very researching project for me. I have worked a lot.
Thank you.
We are from the IDEAL team. And under IDEAL, there are four projects. One was on Anduino. One was on General Health Monitoring System, Data Acquisition System, and Quadcopter. I have been in Anduino group. It's a low-cost board which is as cheap as less than 100 rupees. And when we came here as an intern, number of peripherals have been interfaced to Arduino, and we contributed some more to it by adding some communication devices, by interfacing some communication devices like GSM, GPS, ZigBee, and even DC motors. So once as motors form the movement of robots, we can infer that Arduino will be capable of even making a robo. Further, to emphasize the power of Arduino, we have also made a home automation project, and in which we could control any appliance connected inside a room through. So apart from interfacing a number of peripherals, we had also done a project on home automation system in which one person with an app in his mobile phone or a tablet, it can be any Android phone or Akash tablet or whatever, he will be able to control any device present inside a room through infrared communication. Apart from that, actually home automation system already exists, but in which they electrical wiring of each and every devices had to be altered, instead of which we had made a module which looks like this, in which it can be directly used and used as a plug and use device. So this was a part of our project. Apart from that, this also has a number of advantages and shortcomings. We wanted to use an adapter instead of using a battery. Actually, it has a battery inside. So instead of using a battery, we wanted to use an adapter. I'm just saying some of the future scopes. We can replace this battery with an adapter. We can increase the range by using RF or Zigbee or Bluetooth. And moreover, we can form a network within the home. So these are the contents under the Arduino group. Moreover, we have compiled all these all the works we have done, and it has been pushed in Git. And the book is also about to be released. It is under construction. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to present on GHM. This is the basic structure of the whole system. In general health monitor, we are measuring five vital body parameters, that is body temperature, peak flow, pulse oxy, ECG, and blood pressure. In this system, as you can see, there are three components: the hardware, the Android app, and the web app. From the Android app, we click on a tab and a body parameter, and unique ID is sent, and from there we can measure the values, and is displayed on the Android app. Along with it, we display the status as well, if it's normal or caution or emergency. And if there's no internet connection, then the data is stored temporarily in the SQLite. When internet connection is detected, it is pushed to the server, and the web app is designed basically for the doctor and the patient. They can access the data, the health data, and generate a report as well. Next, please. In our project right now, we have successfully implemented the body temperature, peak flow, and blood pressure. And for ECG and pulse oxy, we're having some problems because we are implementing the circuit and breadboards, and we have lots of noise, so the filtering is needs to be enhanced. Next, please. Future scope, we like to see this as an integrated system and make it wearable device, and we can add more health parameters like blood glucose levels, cholesterol levels. And in the Android app, we can add features like other than status, we can also give suggestions, health tips, and we can also analyze the data and predict the onslaught of a disease before it actually strikes. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My project was eSankalan, a general data purpose data acquisition system. Under this project, the features we could achieve were: make a highly configurable and a user-friendly interface for interfacing ADC, I2C, and UART-based sensors. It is highly configurable, but still the user does not need to go into any details of scripting process, which is very difficult for starters in the electronics world. Generalized I2C models. As people who are using I2C sensor may know that reading the I2C sensor is a very tedious process. It involves a long list of commands with status checks and all. So achieving that model was a big, very big challenge for us, but at last we could achieve it. And because it is also a challenge because at the back end, we need to take care of the delays that are taking place in the execution of those commands, because even a delay of 1 millisecond is very crucial in electronics. Also, we have allowed the user to enter a series of formulae to manipulate the raw data that is coming from the sensors and actually interpret the physical parameter or the value he wants to read. So that was also a very good feature of the project. It includes data logging. Suppose you want to log the data for hours and days for future references and studies. So you cannot keep the tablet on and you can holding it for viewing. So we have included that feature so that the data gets stored on the server and user can retrieve it back and analyze it later. Also, we have made a local database on the Akash tablet for storing the configuration of previously used sensors. So you don't need to enter all the details again and again after you have used it once from the tablet.
We used the Krios AOP flight controller board, and we interfaced Raspberry Pi with it, and we connected a Raspberry Cam, the camera which comes with Raspberry Pi usually, and USB web camera. We interfaced it with the Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Cam is used for image processing purposes, and USB webcam we are using for video streaming. The next thing is door detection. We are aiming to make this quadcopter fully autonomous, which will run on the basis of GPS. However, in a closed door cluttered environment, the GPS gets lost. It can't have access to GPS. So what in that case? So in that case, we have devised an algorithm that it will find an opening to the room. It will go outside the room. It will again have GPS access, and then it can freely navigate.
How many of you had significant exposure to, Arduino is okay, but it's Parent or Raspberry Pi. Did you use these things in your college earlier?
Well, I did not. I did not use Raspberry Pi. I had heard of it, but I got a hands-on experience here.
What about the other members of the team?
No prior experience.
So you could learn and manage?
Yep. The mentors were very supportive, and we also took very, we were given a lot of time to get.
And also the fact that you could work in the labs as long as you wanted.
Yeah.
Does make a difference, right? Thank you so much. Good work.